back to theCUBE. I'm John Furrier, your host here in our Palo Alto studios for Crypto Trailblazer Week. It's 2 days, digital event where all the top crypto innovators who are blazing the trail for the future are coming in to share their opinion. The Ethereum Foundation is in the Bay Area for the week. Variety of activities at Stanford and Berkeley, really initiating and activating the community to get more participation, more minds on some of the core problems as I say Ethereum Act 2 is coming to the market, which is really scaling up and commercializing in a good way the Ethereum capabilities and ushering a new era of decentralized application. Kai is here, he's the co-founder of Reactive Networks, part of the Ethereum ecosystem. Kai, thanks for coming on theCUBE.
Thank you for having me.
And sharing your stories and what you're working on. You know, stories drive movements. Ethereum is a movement, it always has been in my mind from day one. But I say Act 2 mainly because we had that initial optimism and activity, and then we had a little bit of a dark time with COVID, ICOs, NFTs. So a lot of people, you know, get iterating, but you know, and then we're back. You're starting to see scale and a maturization of the people and the ecosystem, and you got more supercomputing capability. You got more power. You got more more people see the future now. It's happening.
Yes,
you're working on it. What's your take on the Ethereum situation, the status of the network, status of the community, and what you're doing, and how that all fits together? Take a minute to explain what's going on in Ethereum, and what problems have been solved, what problems are being solved, and what problems have not yet been solved. Big question was to start you off.
Wow, this is a big question, definitely. Yes. Thank you for having me. So I think in the Ethereum ecosystem right now, we've grown basically over the past almost a decade. Well, it's a decade, actually.
Yeah.
And we've gone through a lot of different phases. And actually, I probably would like to start from what Vitalik himself actually said just yesterday. On Monday. So there's basically always a competing sort of, I would say, attention and focus between two different camps, one on scaling and one on value. They are not mutually exclusive, but sometimes they tend to clash because which one are you going to focus on first? And I think Ethereum has reached a point where, yes, scale is an issue. And that's why we have layer twos, sometimes layer threes. And we have a lot of different people coming with different solutions. And they say, let's try to do this. And they slap some solutions on top, some of it at the side of it. I think fundamental sort of clash between value and basic skill is really on, you have limited resources, which one are you trying to focus on first? So at the end of the day, if you can have both, why not both? Mm-hmm. And that to me is the fundamental sort of clash in this cycle for Ethereum ecosystem. I like to start with this because he mentioned it, mm-hmm. and it resonated a lot with me. A lot of the solutions that we see right now focus on skill, some of it on value, but a lot of the times they start off with, okay, let's build something, hopefully open source, but vast majority are actually kind of still closed source, still centralized. It introduced a lot of sort of centralized potential point of failures into the entire ecosystem. Not all of it is bad. Sometimes, yes, you do need to take things in a more centralized manner. So for example, blockchain data is very often centrally sort of distributed. It's out there. You can tap onto it. You can sort of study it on your own if you have the resources, the computing power. But most of the time, if you want to have a working product, a working business product, yeah. Which responds to sort of all the various different things happening on chain, you either do it yourself or you tap onto a provider who's more or less structured in a more centralized manner. And the reason they have to do it is because blockchain data is not reactive, it's not interactive with the data that's happening in it. You actually need to put it off and then you sort of bookmark it, yeah. Sort it out and find what you want, yeah. Before you actually react back onto the chain.
And your venture you just launched this week, Reactive Network, explain that, take us through the history, how you got there and what are you doing?
Yeah, so Reactive Network is something that we built with actually the central tenants of the Ethereum ecosystem in mind. We want it to be open source. We want it to be on-chain. We want to basically solve blockchain technology problems using blockchain technology. Like, why are we building all of this entire tech stack out of blockchain if it can be solved on-chain? So that's where we came from. Our history is that we started from on-chain, if this then that. That was like Genesis 6 years ago. And we moved into indexing, and eventually we picked up on all of these lessons we learned, and we look at this, and we look at actually the Ethereum white paper. A long time ago, when it first came out, there were two key things that they were trying to solve, and they were trying to do. Blockchains, obviously, if you put a code on it, they say, let's publish the things that's happening, and let's enable subscribing on-chain.
Yeah.
Publishing, well, was done on day one. Anything happens, there's an events log, it's published. Subscribing is where it gets very difficult. I will not go into the technical details behind it.
Yeah.
But essentially, if you look at it from a non-Web3 point of view, if you're a developer and you're comfortable building on the other tech stacks that's not Web3, you're maybe you're a Google developer, yeah, or somewhere else, and you look at it, it's like, wait, it doesn't make sense. What do you mean your code can't respond to events?
Yeah.
But that's essentially what happens on this in this space broadly right now.
And what problem did you solve? What was the main problem you solved?
So the main problem that we want to solve is to enable smart contracts, basically a code that's deployed on Web3 to respond to events. That's it. That's the one sentence solution that we want to solve. And why is that important? It's because if it can't respond to events on-chain, what everyone in this industry is doing is to pull it off-chain, deploy a separate code, and because you're deploying a separate code on a different tech stack, it's written in a different language. And then you have to sort it out, and then you have to talk between the two layers, on-chain, off-chain, understand the requirements on both sides, and then react back on-chain.
A lot of work.
A lot of work.
So there's heavy lifting involved there, that's gone.
Yes, what we want to do is, if you can do it on-chain, and written in the same code, why not? And that to me is really just the start. What we want to do with Reactive Network is to enable developers to, oh, now I do not need to spend all my time coding all of this thing and just trying to make sure that part works. Now it's just, oh, I'm using the same code. I have a smart contract on layer one, so layer two, on base, on Arbitrum. And then I have a Reactive smart contract that sort of helped me solve all these Reactive needs I need. As long as you have a business,
yep,
you need some reactivity. If this thing happens, my code needs to be able to see it and react in real time. And now I just deploy it using the same code. And that means, what does that mean? It means that the developers can now think, okay, what can my platform or my business solve for other things, for new things? And they can code things in a much more streamlined manner.
So productivity is critical there, developer productivity. Better efficiency with the data.
Yes.
That solves that problem. What's been the reaction? You're out here in the Bay Area.
Yes.
A parade for you. Hey, thank you very much. What's been the conversations you've had?
It was extremely encouraging because what happened was actually we are sponsoring the hackathon for Ethereum SF. And we talk about the bounties. And before we talk about bounties, we just shared, yeah, this is a Reactive Network, we had 1 minute, and we just talk about essentially what this means. One sentence, like, you know, it's fully on-chain, and you have Reactive smart contracts. And it was to not too many people, but right after that, we have multiple projects approaching us, like, hey, this is interesting. Because for the first time, the developers have a paradigm shift. When they approach Web3, they were thinking, oh, the old way of doing it, I have to do this, I have to do that, I need to put in maybe 3 months to make sure I pull the data off, 2 tech stacks, 4 tech stacks, 6 tech stacks talking to each other, and yeah, then after that, I solve my problem. But now it's like, oh, everything's just one.
So all that provisioning, essentially, of the technical stacks just to get going.
Precisely.
It's kind of like building a data center versus going to the cloud. People think of it that way.
Precisely. And I think one of the most exciting things is that people are starting to think about new solutions that were not really possible previously. I say it's not possible from a technical standpoint because if you connect enough tech stacks and you have enough time and resources, you probably can solve it in a relatively complicated manner. But the reality in this space is that things are moving so quickly and we're really trying in my view, we are actually trying to catch up with the non-Web3 space, and now they can.
Talk about the hackathon. What were some of the things that jumped out at you at the hackathon that might have surprised you? Any mindset shift or project or hack that looked great? Any results you can share? Stories there?
Yeah, of course, people are still hacking and people are asking questions. But I think one of the exciting things as we are talking to different developers is basically this. Right now, of course, the market is kind of iffy.
Yeah.
They're looking at it and asking themselves, what can they potentially make big breakthroughs? AI is the big talk of well, the space for a while. AI and how it interacts with Web3. And they started looking at us because if you're deploying AI, machine learning, and all that, it needs reactive data.
Yeah.
It needs to be able to jump at things.
Yeah.
And you can't do it organically on-chain. And straight away, we are coming forward and said, now you can.
Yeah.
And they see that because straight away, it solves all their problems.
The data is more organized or at least more consistent on-chain now than before. You had off-chain, on-chain.
Precisely.
More moving parts.
So now all they need to do is to use this, like for example, Solidity.
Yep.
They build a reactive smart contract on us. And maybe I have a platform on Base. And now I can listen in. And not just on Base, maybe on five other different chains. I can listen in. My code will automatically pick up on all the events that's happening. Yep. And my code will automatically react because that's what it's coded for. That cuts out a lot of the problems, and in fact, it enables a lot of new functions that the entire industry is actually currently trying to struggle with. A lot of the UX big changes that people were trying to go for, if you're trying to do it on-chain and off-chain, there's a lot of complexity involved.
Yeah.
But if you do everything on-chain, it cuts a lot of that work off.
And one of the benefits of AI that everyone's raving about that's obvious is the code assistance. Is we heard from Siri before when he was on about how the LLMs, you can say, give me a smart contract. So how has the models helped with Solidity and some of the integration? Has that been come up a lot? Is that something that you're seeing where there's leverage now with the AI potentially?
It's something that we actually started hearing from other AI companies since at least half a year ago. To them, the holy grail is this. Someone who's obviously not a coder, not a developer, no knowledge of it whatsoever, goes to the AI agent and say, hey, I have $1,000 here. Can you turn it into $10,000 for me? Go.
Okay, that's a great prompt.
What's the answer? Yes, and that's the holy grail. And the AI agent will be like, okay. It might ask a few questions like, what's your risk profile, et cetera, and it just go. And the AI agent writes the code. But if it just writes typical smart contracts, there is that off-chain side of things that it's not that easy for them to link up with unless the AI agents already have existing partnerships with all these APIs and, okay, I can pull all this data. I need to write other codes outside of blockchain as well to sort of make it happen. But they want to talk to us because, now they just need to deploy a reactive smart contract.
Yeah.
And straight away, all of that part, at least the on-chain part of the house, it's all settled. That's to them is the holy grail. Yeah. And they were very excited because we enabled the whole thing to be just coded with Solidity.
Yeah.
Nothing new for them.
Yeah, and that's awesome. And it's going to open up the aperture of more people building apps for sure. What's your vision for Reactive Network? What's next? What are you hoping to accomplish? What are some of your goals?
I think my goal is really to bring basically this Web3 possibilities to the non-Web3 space, the commercial side of the house. I think right now in this industry, we're still very focused on financial sort of solutions because, more than 90% of anything that's happening on Web3 are related to finance. Yeah. DeFi, other basic tokens, a lot of trades, options, derivatives, and all of it. I think the real delta comes in when real life use cases with logistics, with gaming product codes, with all of this movement of real goods come in and they use this as a solution.
Yeah.
And they're not going to look at it and say that, if I need to deploy it on using a Web3 tech stack, it's not just one tech stack, it's like five.
Yeah.
And it's complicated, but why do I need to handle this when I can just build it on a typical cloud service?
Yeah, real infrastructure.
Data, yeah.
Yeah, decentralized infrastructures.
Yes, and I see it as a big delta where we enable them coming in, and finally they'd be like, okay, actually it's just one tech stack. That's relatively easy.
Yeah.
The data storage, of course, will be off-chain, that's fine.
Yeah.
They know how to handle that.
Yeah.
They have experience doing it. And the go-to market is so much faster.
Yeah.
And the way I see it, imagine a day where your gaming product codes, or your logistics, for example, from point to point. If it's a gaming product code, for example, I'm a game studio, I produce the product codes, 1 million of them, or 10 million. And I issue out to the various different vendors, like Steam, PlayStation,
yeah. And
so on.
Yeah.
And it goes to the players who buys them. And the players, after playing for 2 months, 3 months, maybe they want to resell it end to end. To the second layers of players and to the third layers of players,
yeah.
Me as publisher, I can keep track of the whole thing. Yeah. It's immutable.
It's an economy, it's a marketplace.
Precisely. And it's big data. And I can actually create code that responds automatically to all of these changes as well. Maybe on Tuesday, the sales are pretty bad. My code will automatically trigger and say, let's have sales on Tuesday.
Yeah. You put some policy on it, logic. Business logic.
Yes.
So solutions is the future.
Yes. Right now, all of this is pretty manual.
Yeah.
But with this, it actually enables companies to start looking at, okay, maybe I can look at Web3 as kind of solution.
Yeah, so the scale and value still are in play, not mutually exclusive, both independent, but related.
But related, yes, precisely.
Kai, thank you so much for coming on theCUBE. Final question, stories drive movements. What's your favorite story this week from the Bay Area movement that's happening here?
Wow. Actually, the big story to me that I'm really, really interested in is actually what's coming to happen tomorrow, where tomorrow is all about DAG, which Vitalik was talking about.
Mm-hmm.
My background, before I joined this industry, I was actually in law enforcement. And so security is like, can understand it. Actually, that's my original playing field.
You get sucked into the rabbit hole and wow, this is a really great environment.
It is. And the thing about whether a physical security or a cybersecurity, the weakest link is the part that will break the whole thing. It's not about how well you build the entire house. It's actually the weakest link, whichever it is. Usually it's the door or the humans or the windows, wherever it is. And in DAG, I think it's a very good way to look at it from a standpoint where you're really trying to eliminate weakest points and weakest links. Very often it's centralized, very often it's human.
Yeah.
And you're trying to use this technology and adapt it in all various different kind of use cases and various different verticals and various different industries.
Right.
To me, that is the fun thing to be.
DAG is huge, accelerating fast. Thanks for coming on theCUBE. Appreciate the stories and congratulations on the launch of your venture. And good luck. We'll keep in touch.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
We are here for the Crypto Trailblazer series. I'm John Furrier. Thanks for watching.